I recently attended the cross-country carnival at my kids' elementary school. It was a beautiful, sunny morning, and hundreds of kids were gathered on the grassy field with their classmates, excited to run. I watched from the sidelines, ready with my phone to record, as my kid, Zoomer, sat with all the other kindergartners awaiting their race. And then, what I was hoping wouldn't happen, happened. One of the race organizers said, "Okay, kindergarten boys, stand up and come to the starting line." Around 30 to 40 boys, including Zoomer, stood up from the group, hurried over to the line, and took off after a 3-2-1 countdown. Some boys were super fast. Some tripped and face-planted into the grass and got up laughing, trying to catch up. And some boys were not enthused about running at all and slowly made their way around the 400-meter course. After about 30 seconds, the kindergarten girls were asked to stand up and got their 3-2-1 countdown and took off across the same starting line. I cheered for Zoomer as he ran around the track and towards the finish line in the group of fastest boys. And then I turned my attention to the other racers. And I watched as some girls had caught up to and passed many of the boys, and as some girls tripped and face planted into the grass and got up laughing, just like their classmates. I'm a social scientist and an advocate for anti-sexist education. And my mind was swirling with thoughts and questions and disappointment about the kids being separated by binary gender. I'm Dr. Kyle, and I'm sharing three evidence-based reasons for why young children of all genders should compete together in sports. And before you go, "But testosterone," remember, this video is about sporting events for kids who still have a bunch of their baby teeth. Reason number one. Prepubescent children are more similar than different when it comes to their athletic abilities. Testosterone is mentioned as a reason for separating boys and girls in sports, but all bodies produce testosterone. And until age 9, kids have similar, low, and stable testosterone levels. Prior to puberty, there are no meaningful sex differences in circulating testosterone concentrations or athletic performance. Sex and gender are not binaries. There's way more variation among females and among males and among intersex kids than between them all. There's tall girls and strong boys and fast non-binary kids. The whole point of categorizing sporting events by sex is to ensure one group doesn't have a physical advantage over another, which simply isn't the case for early childhood and community sports. There aren't significant sex-based differences between prepubescent kids in height, weight, strength, or endurance. Research shows that the sex-based divergence in elite athletic performance in swimming, running, and jumping track and field events begins at the age of 12 to 13, parallel to the average onset of puberty and males' testosterone increases around age 11 or 12. This is after most kids have left elementary school. Remember middle school? If kids' athletic abilities are so overlapping in early childhood, why do we separate them by gender in sports? Because of stereotypes. Which leads me to reason number two. Because of gendered misconceptions about children's physical abilities and a history of sports being dominated by men, kids are exposed to sexist stereotypes and bias about athleticism from birth. Look no further than the fact that most of us grew up understanding that the phrase, "you run like a girl," was an insult. Bias about male superiority doesn't appear in grade school. It begins in infancy. In one research study, 11-month-old infants were placed on a ramp, and their crawling abilities were measured. The male and female babies showed identical levels of motor performance. What differed was their mother's estimations of their crawling abilities. Mothers of boys overestimated their son's performance, and mothers of girls underestimated their daughters. A lifetime of girls being underestimated leads to them having fewer opportunities and less encouragement and practice to achieve their athletic potential compared to boys. We know that prepubescent children are more similar than they are different. But as kids age, gender socialization contributes to a diversion in some motor skills. girls start to outperform boys in balance and flexibility, and boys start to outperform girls in agility and speed. Generally, girls and boys are socialized in different ways. They're given different names and toys, different clothes and hairstyles, called by different adjectives, and experience different expectations and restrictions. Gender stereotypes and enforced binaries in childhood are barriers to athletic skill-building experiences. For example, a cultural code where girls frequently wear dresses but boys never do can negatively affect girls' crawling, climbing, and running development and give boys an advantage. It is critical for adults to counter sexist stereotypes in childhood sports and facilitate opportunities for kids of all genders to build confidence in their athletic abilities and compete together. The more positive interactions kids have with children of other genders, the more likely they are to develop egalitarian, anti-sexist attitudes and disregard the stereotype that sports are for boys. Reason number three. There are a lot of kids with genders between and beyond the boy-girl binary. Having a girl race and a boy race isn't inclusive of many children who are intersex, non-binary, transitioning, or still exploring their gender identity. We don't have great national or global data to understand the self-determined gender identities of most kids, but there is growing visibility of gender-diverse children and research showing that all kids don't fit into one of two boxes. A recent study in New Zealand found that among 6,000 8-year-olds, 2% identify with a gender different to that assigned to them at birth, and 1 in 7 identify as being somewhere between a girl and a boy. And an estimated 1 in every 1,000 babies are born with intersex variations and have sex chromosomes or reproductive anatomy that may be different than what is typically categorized as male or female. Some intersex kids identify as boys or girls, and some don't. We wouldn't think of saying blonde kids here and brunettes over there, because there are kids with red hair and black hair, no hair and multicolor hair. Nothing about kids is this or that. Events that are categorized by binary sex can be distressing for lots of kiddos. If contests need to be split into smaller groups for different heats, there are ways to do that without perpetuating bias and excluding gender-diverse kids. Last name starting with letters A through L in this line and M to Z in this one. You're an apple, you're an orange, you're a pear. You're an apple, you're an orange, you're a pear. All right, oranges, you're up first. Childhood is a unique and amazing life phase. It's full of play, development, self-discovery, and learning about the world and human diversity. Grown-ups, we've got an opportunity here to help kids unlearn gender stereotypes and get used to competing and playing together, which they'll be doing for the rest of their lives off the field. Making elementary school and community sporting events inclusive of kids of all genders and abilities is not hindering potential world record holders, but it might just make the world a bit more equitable and help kids understand that sports are for everyone. Please share this video with school administrators and coaches and policymakers, and commit to interrogating your own biases about children's abilities. Together, we can advocate for non-gendered youth sports and set our sights on a new finish line where kids get to be kids and sexism doesn't ruin the fun. On your marks,